Researchers from Mount Holyoke released a new study that shows some concern for women who vape during pregnancy. The study shows the liquid used to form e-juice in vapes could have neurological effects on their baby. Carolee McGrath sat down with Jared Schwartzer, Associate Professor of Neuroscience at Mount Holyoke, and Jamie Church, a postdoctoral student, to learn more.
The question is, what are the effects of vaping during pregnancy? Vaping has come on the market as a safer alternative to smoking tobacco cigarettes, and even that comment is a bit of a charged comment. So what we don't know is, what are the consequences of vaping to the developing child, and do they have any lasting consequences? And these are ethically challenging questions to ask in humans, so we use mice to help us address them.
So Jamie, tell me a little bit about your involvement in the study and how it was conducted.
We challenged the mothers during pregnancy. We exposed them to electronic cigarette vapors with or without nicotine. And we asked some behavioral questions on the adult offspring. So the adult offspring from the mothers exposed to electronic cigarette vapor with nicotine showed elevations in activity or hyperactivity. And that's not surprising given what we know about the effects of nicotine from tobacco smoke. Interestingly, however, the offspring from mothers exposed to the electronic cigarette vapor alone showed deficits in learning and memory. And to a lesser extent, we also saw these effects in offspring from mothers exposed to e-cigarette vapors with nicotine.
Okay, so that obviously is a huge concern for any parent out there, because we know that we're so sensitive now, of course, to learning disabilities and really trying to help kids, you know, navigate many different issues.
That's right.
And this is another layer.
Right.
So that's an interesting find.
Right. I think it's so powerful because the vaping world is using a liquid to dissolve their nicotine or THC. And these substances haven't been really regulated for breathing in that way. They're really meant for other uses. And so we don't know what the consequences are of not just the nicotine, but the other substances that you're vaping in.
So when you're talking about, obviously we know that nicotine, you know, is a problem, but I think you mentioned earlier on that a lot of people, maybe somebody who, you know, is a smoker says, well, this will be much safer during my 9 months of pregnancy.
Right.
Certainly that's how the whole vaping thing has been pitched.
That's right. And I think that that's a challenging statement to make, because we don't have enough research to support it or refute it, right? I think outside of pregnancy, there is some research that suggests that vaping may be a better alternative to smoking if someone is already a smoker. But how that translates to a pregnancy, which is a much more sensitive time, that doesn't always translate, because we don't know what vaping is doing to the developing fetus, if it is safer than tobacco cigarettes.
Right, and when you talk about, you know, the potential for, you know, learning, you know, problems because of vaping, what's the next step in the study? How do you continue this?
So some of the things that we're interested in, we've looked at the long-term effect on adult offspring behavior, but we also need to examine the other constituents within electronic cigarettes. So we looked at the vehicle, the liquid that you use to dissolve nicotine, and nicotine, but there are other constituents with electronic cigarettes. So something else that we could look at, for instance, are the flavorings that are added. And so those have been approved for eating and they're added to certain foods, but we don't know the consequences when you inhale them. Furthermore, the vehicle used to dissolve the nicotine is something commonly found in, for instance, a fog machine. And so populations that regularly engage with that machinery, say in theater production, we want to know what, if any, effects there are for being regularly exposed to that.
And what has been the response that you've gotten so far on this study?
Well, there's certainly a lot of interest in it. The study right now is under review with the scientific community. So one of the important pieces of research is slowing down and sharing it with a bunch of our peers in the community and letting them look at it and scrutinize it and make sure that we've controlled properly, we've thought about interpreting our data the right way. And so right now it's under review at a journal known as Environmental Health Perspectives. It's a journal put out by the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences. And we're waiting to hear back what the scientific community feels about the study, how we might want to position in a way that accurately represents the data we have, and hoping through the peer review process, the end result is a stronger representation of the work we've done.
And how long did the study take you?
We started this fall. It began at Mount Holyoke in the fall of 2018 when we were conducting the behavioral analyses. So this was about a year ago, and we started the experiment at our institution.
When you talked a little bit about, you know, vaping right now certainly being a politically charged subject, you know, there's a recent ban in Massachusetts, which people have strong feelings on both right. sides of the aisle. And here you have this study in the midst of that.
Right.
It's an interesting topic that you chose. How do you feel about the ban, and where do you see this whole, I guess, vaping, where do you see this going
right.
in the future?
So the challenge with responding to the ban is that we don't have enough information in the scientific community to make an educated assessment. I think the rise of vaping has happened, and the popularity of it has happened at a much faster pace than what science can keep up with. So policy should be made based on informed scientific research, and we don't have the research to support or to understand the situation. I think there's a long history of negative consequences to prohibition, and I think government agencies have to think carefully about the public health consequences of prohibition, and thinking about risk versus benefit. Is it prohibition or is it regulation that'll lead to the most beneficial outcome for public health?
Jamie, tell me a little bit about the population that you're looking at as far as those who are most likely to vape.
So we know that the most common population who is vaping are those of childbearing age, and that while electronic cigarettes are being touted as a safer alternative to tobacco cigarettes, that doesn't mean that they're safe. And so our study was looking at mice, which doesn't mean it translates 100% to humans, but these findings make me at least self-reflect on the choices I made as a twice pregnant person and the lifestyle choices that I made, and what are the potential consequences of that on the health and development of my offspring. We know that the brain is vulnerable to its environment even beginning in utero, and so we need to understand all of the choices that a pregnant person could be making so that we have the healthiest children coming forward. And we really need to make sure that we have well-informed prenatal care.
And Jared, you did look at very closely at brain development as well.
Yeah, and in fact, that's one of the highlights of our study is that the liquid that we use to dissolve the nicotine that is commonly used in vape products have lasting consequences, lasting changes on the offspring's brain chemistry. We're seeing differences in the immune system or the health of the brain. We're not sure yet what it means and how it translates, but to think that a mother who's vaping during pregnancy could lead to differences in brain health to their child way into adulthood is a pretty substantial finding.